There wasn't enough of the power of suggestion in the bites in Dark Shadows. Fortunately, there were only about 5 minutes in all the 4 or 5 years I was on the show. It was only about 5 minutes of actual biting time, thank God. So I didn't have to really worry too much about it because I got on with the other aspects of the character. And I was coming in to zap Maggie through these windows. And if you look carefully at the thing, because we taped these things without stopping as much as we could. And they didn't stop for this, but I had to get rid of them because they didn't fit in and I had to open my mouth. So it turned out to be the best bite I ever did, by the way, because I couldn't open my mouth in this idiotic fashion that they always asked me to do. To the camera, as if they wanted to show off the fact they'd spent $100 on a pair of dentures. I mean, it was just silly. But they'd go, and then I'd go in and, you know, they could have called the cops and saved the poor damsel by the time I got to her neck. But with that episode, because I couldn't use them because they weren't in, I just chewed them up like a kid in class caught chewing gum and he puts them in the back behind his teeth or something. And I put them back and somehow went down at her. There was the camera and I went down like this with my mouth barely open. So you weren't sure whether you could see fangs or not. And that's the way it should be done, frankly. There's nothing, any long dentures and things look funny to me. They don't look horrible at all. But if you can suggest it, the power of suggestion is, because what I'm into my whole career, including my one-man show, is into the power of suggestion. I played it with all the seriousness of a Hamlet. I mean, I was playing a role that was as good as anything I've ever done. And it did develop into all these facets. But some people kind of overacted or thought they were in something kind of campy. I don't think it was camp at all. I never had that attitude. I was sick. But sometimes I thought even the writers got into that attitude. So they allowed themselves license for doing impossible things. I always played him as a sensible man. I guess I used my father as a kind of an image. Because he would have hysterics if he were been alive to see all this. And me to say that as a result, but I tried to play him as an intelligent, capable man. He just had this particular problem. He came from good family. There's nothing wrong with good family. I know it's a derogatory concept nowadays, but he was from good family, good stock, healthy, and intelligent. He just had this one little problem. So he dealt with these problems in the most intelligent way he could, in the most sensible way he could. So there was that side of him that gave him, I thought, gave him strength and gave him cause for being. Then he was vulnerable. He was passionate, of course, forgetting the whole vampire part of it. He was passionate, and he had his loves, and he had his hatred for the one who loved him. He couldn't reciprocate. He couldn't respond to the witch's love, and that's why she gave him the curse. The one thing that I had to play all the time is to covering up. I mean, I was playing the lie. I was like a politician. I was like any human being that has to cover up certain private aspects of his life that can't be known. So I was playing that most consistently. I never played vampire, ever. I played him with human values without giving any attention to the strict rules of what a vampire should be. In fact, if I had done that, he probably would have come out a very dull, lifeless, bloodless creep, interesting for about 5 minutes, and then that's it. It's like watching a dinosaur for 5 minutes. I mean, you can't have a whole series about a dinosaur or about a fish swimming around. So he had to be. So we had to forget all that, and I know they did, so I went right along. And I just played a human being. I suppose the closest thing, the literal thing that I took as a parallel at that time was Ray Milland and Lost Weekend. And it was an alcoholic. recovering alcoholic. But of course, his problem was a lot worse because it wasn't just an indulgence. He had to have blood to live by. So it was more than just an indulgence that he had to get over. He just simply had to come to terms with it and get it whatever way he could without being too injurious to people. But he had to do that to survive. He was a predator. All the soaps were all in New York. Some of them moved out to the coast eventually, but they all started here. I'm no authority on that, but that's my impression.
Yeah.
I mean, most of the soaps were here, and I think most of the soaps are still here. Maybe half of them are done out on the coast, but in those days, most of them were definitely done here. It was one time when I wanted to get out, and I was in a hurry for some other appointment. And so they let me out the back way. Our studio faced 53rd Street, and that was the normal way to go out. And I hadn't been aware of this scene dock at the back of the building on 54th Street, and there was a door there, and they let me out that way. And then I had to come around, however, to 53rd around this parking lot. Oh, no, I beg your pardon. I'd done that one day. Then, and the next time I pulled this, I made a ruse. I pretended I was going to do that because they'd already were on to this, you see. So I went out that way, and then I didn't. I came back. They all went around, and then I came out the front door. And one of the mothers was there, and she said, "How dare you treat those children like that? How dare you?" She was furious. And no feeling. I had to take that sometimes. You know, that's how heavy they were into it. And this grown mother. I thought that poor child having a mother that stupid. I mean, you know, I had to get out of the building, and she just dressed me down like nobody's business. How dare you treat the children like this? I had an appointment to get to, and I was playing games with them. There was one day where Joan and Lewis and I were trying to get out, and we saw the door, and they were just packed in the window, glass door. And I said, I'll take care of them. And I went right up to them, and I just gave them their own back, and I went, like a silly girl, you know, and of course they all just scattered. And fortunately, I could have been responsible for an awful scene there because they all ran out onto the street. And of course they thought I was doing my horror number. I was just doing them. I was just mimicking them. And they thought that was horrible enough, which was interesting. But anyway, but they all ran out onto the street, and of course there could have been cars coming down, and they would have knocked them down like ninepins. Fortunately, that didn't happen. But anyway, I hadn't thought of that. But anyway, at least we got away. Joan and Lewis and I ran up the street. No, we just walked quickly. They were very good about that. Once you got beyond the property line of the building, it seemed they would leave you alone. They never came up and bothered you at 9th Avenue where we had to hail taxis, and sometimes we'd be there for 5 or 10 minutes. You know, in those days, everybody used cabs because they were cheap. And so it was awfully hard to get a cab in those days. And but those kids left us alone when we went through that ordeal. You'd think that would have been the time to get us, you see. But I guess we probably did it once where we said, "Come on, knock it off," because we got to get home. So they didn't want that confrontation. So they kept. But to get out of the building was the problem.